Hollow Knight is one of the most tightly designed games I have ever seen. And in today's episode, we're going to be taking a look at the game design techniques that actually make this possible, and where it succeeds and fails. So spoiler warning from this point onwards, guys, and welcome to the anatomy of Hollow Knight. Our story follows the unnamed knight, a lonely bug from a distant land, where he stumbles his way into Hollownest, a decrepit land of death, sorrow, and madness.
I'm in danger!
Right, okay, we then follow the knight's journey to uncover the cause of this land's destruction and to save or destroy its remaining insectoid inhabitants. So, for anyone who doesn't already know, Hollow Knight is a Metroidvania game, and this subgenre is inspired by the sprawling and twisting map design of the Metroid series and the punishing combat of the Castlevania series, and it's the combination of these two games that make up the Metroidvania subgenre. To put it simply, in Hollow Knight, you travel through Hollownest, unlocking new abilities to access previously inaccessible areas in a sprawling maze-like map. But you already know this, and for anyone who's already played Hollow Knight, you know that it is so satisfying to play. Combat and platforming just glide together so effortlessly. But why is this? Why does it feel so good to play? Well, this is due in part to its subtle balance of game feel. So, in my episode on Katana Zero, we spoke about how the developers used animations such as screen shake and deep, low-end sound design to make Zero feel strong and powerful, but in Hollow Knight, they're trying to achieve the exact opposite. They want you to feel small and weak, like an insignificant bug in a gigantic, decrepit world, and changing the smallest details about how a character either looks or controls can completely change how the game feels overall. So just like with Katana Zero, let's take a look at the knight's attack. Well, the highest contributing factor to this game feel is that the knight himself is knocked back when he attacks. And this tiny detail makes the knight feel so much smaller, and makes the enemies feel so much more powerful and immovable in comparison to the knight. But along with this attack, the most prevalent action you'll be performing throughout the entire game is jumping. And to describe the game feel design of the jump, we're going to have to go into some programming mumbo jumbo, so strap yourselves in. So when creating a jump, we have to factor for three values. We have the speed of the initial jump, or how fast your jump begins. We then have gravity, or how quickly the character then loses that momentum of the initial jump. And then finally, terminal velocity, or the maximum speed at which they can fall back down to the ground. And skewing with any of these values can drastically alter how a jump feels and how the player will perceive their character. To give you an example, if you have a high initial jump speed, then your character is going to feel really powerful. If your gravity is too high, that boy's going to feel extra thick, and having a low terminal velocity is going to make your character feel really floaty, and a lot of people describe the knight's jump as floaty. And yes, this is due to his terminal velocity being incredibly low. And smaller objects actually have lower terminal velocity, so that makes perfect sense. But this, coupled with the relatively low initial jump speed and the gradual curve of his gravity, makes him feel weaker, lighter, and incredibly small. Sorry to interrupt, random fact of the day. Talking about feeling small, blue whales are so big that humans could swim through their arteries. I don't know why you would, but you could. But enough about that. This small, weightless, sometimes even ethereal feeling is completely conveyed through just some physics numbers. And an interesting side effect to this floaty game feel is the amount of control and accuracy it gives the player in its movement and combat. And this is important when trying to encourage mechanical mastery. But first off, what is mechanical mastery? Well, mechanical mastery is the state where once the mechanics of the game become settled into your muscle memory, everything just melts away, and you just do. You don't need to think about pressing the buttons during gameplay, it just happens. And this is sometimes called reaching flow state or being in the zone. And the Mantis Lords are a perfect example of this mechanical mastery in motion. When the Mantis Lords are first introduced, you are challenged with facing one of them. It has three attacks, a dash, a plunge, and a spinning blade bullshit, and in this first phase, it allows for the player to become comfortable with these three attack patterns. Then phase two begins, and the two in phase two stands for two, because there are two of them. And it's in this moment that this flow state and mechanical mastery shows its true colours. The boundaries of the arena fade away, and you're completely enveloped in the fight. There are so many attacks flying at you that you have no time to think, you just do. And what you feel here, this is flow state. And mastery over the mechanics of the game must be achieved for flow state to even be possible. And reaching this state of mastery is so much more difficult when the player is overloaded with options. And instead of giving the player hundreds of unique options for them to keep track of, Hollow Knight has compartmentalized its controls to be simpler so that platforming and combat become one. For example, a huge focus of the game is the Knight's down slash attack, which can be used as a pogo-like jump in platforming or during combat to attack and bypass enemies, giving it huge combat and platforming applications just through one button press. Something we say to new developers when they first start out is KISS. Not like kiss me, but like K-I-S-S. Keep it simple, stupid. The simpler the mechanics are, the better chance the player has at developing mechanical mastery, which is intensely more satisfying and gratifying than just having a couple more options in combat. And no, don't get me wrong, there is a ton of choice in this game with its charm system, but each one of these charms only alters the core mechanics of combat and platforming, which allows for the player to fully focus on enemy attacks and countering them, and Hollow Knight nails this aspect of its combat design. Something else that the developers really nailed is how they naturally teach the player to observe and navigate through the world of Hollow Nest non-intrusively. So standard 2D level design teaching methods are once again used here, such as directional character movement through the world to help guide the player where to go, points of no return to teach the player how to use their abilities, and ability blockades to stagger player exploration. And you can go watch my episodes on the Ori series for a deeper dive into those techniques, but Hollow Knight is a wonderful example of how to condition the player to scour the map for secrets through play conditioning. And the best example of this is how the game teaches the player to look for secret breakable walls. Now, when designing something like this, you want to do it without just going, "Oi, mate, there are breakable walls, you pleb. Off you pop." Well, instead of doing that, we want to do it in a non-intrusive way to keep that tasty immersion intact, and Hollow Knight does this simply by introducing the player to gear. This is the game's currency, and it can be found hidden around in the dark corners of Hollow Nest. And then they are introduced to what it buys, you know, some chicken nuggets and Thomas the Tank Engine DVDs, so the game wants the player to want this currency. That's step one. Then once this conditioning and love for Geo sets in, the player will jump at any chance to get Geo wherever they can. So imagine the player's surprise when they stumble into the first area and they spot this horde of Geo just sitting there. And then once the player begins to take this third Geo node, the wall behind it falls apart, teaching the player that there are secrets hidden within this game and they should be looking out for them. And yes, this is incredibly simple, but consider the alternative. Just telling the player with simple text boxes, which just slices the thin veil of immersion completely in half. And this keeps the player naturally in the game world, paying attention to their environment by looking and listening. And yes, listening. Because another one of Hollow Knight's greatest achievements is its careful use of its sound. You all knew this was coming, Jay gushing over sound design again. For anyone who doesn't already know, I am a sound designer, and I'm incredibly passionate about sound's utilization in the design of games, and Hollow Knight is a beautiful example of using sound signifiers to subtly guide the player instead of using immersion-breaking bullshit like text boxes.
I hate text boxes.
Yeah, me too, mate. I think they've got it now. Anyway, in Hollow Knight, there are many things in the game that the player should be looking out for, like the secret areas we just mentioned, hidden collectibles like the grubs, or Cornifer the Mapmaker, and before you're able to see a lot of these, you can hear them. The trapped grubs crying out in pain, the kindly humming Mapmaker happily scribbling away at his work, or the distant hum of air conditioners, and all of these sounds can help guide the player in certain directions of progression and further secrets. And yes, there are visual guides for this, like the scattered papers of the Mapmaker that can help lead the player, but by using a sound as a signifier as well, this expands the overall range of how the developers can guide the player to beyond the play screen. And just like we spoke about in the Anatomy of Outer Wilds video, these sounds can also create mystery motivation on what these sounds actually are and what's creating them, encouraging the player to start thinking and investigating for themselves. And an example of this investigation in motion is with, again, the Mapmaker Cornifer. And at this point in the game, we find him here, and the next thing for us to do is to make our way across the map to this brutally punishing area. And if you die, the run back is incredibly long and grueling. but while progressing through this area, we happen upon an elevator, and this is a rare moment of respite and a chance for us to take our eyes off of the game. But then we hear the distant, ruffled sound of Cornifer's song. This grabs our attention, and if we investigate further, we find a hidden shortcut that cuts out this entire grueling run. And all of this signified through sound. This is just a beautiful, organic design, and takes the player away from just obsessively looking at the map.
What?
Oh, yeah, I'm sorry, Cornifer, I've got some really big problems with your map design.
Oh, no.
Right, okay, and now I want to begin this section by saying that I do not have a problem with the level design of these individual areas. I think they are incredibly crafted, fun, and engaging. The twisting pipe maze of the Royal Waterways, or the carnivorous boughs of Greenpath and the fungal wastes, the enemies, platforming, and story are all incredible, but I do have a problem with how they actually flow into one another. It's incredibly easy to just get lost in this game. I call these types of games Wikipedia games, games that require you to look up what to do if you're not willing to go through a ton of trial and error. Consider it the modern day equivalent to having to buy Nintendo Power to be told the secret of how to progress. And oh, what series was most famous for doing that? Oh yeah, the Castlevania series. A coincidence? I think not. Anyway, an example of this in Hollow Knight is when you finally want to fight one of the three bosses needed for the game's easiest ending. Well, to get to this boss, you need to get through this black void wall which is located here. And it's incredibly simple to get through this wall. All you need to do is travel all the way down to Deep Nest, get the tram pass, then take the tram to Ancient Basin, defeat a boss, unlock the double jump ability, then travel all the way to Kingdom's Edge, defeat another boss to get the King's Brand, travel back to Ancient Basin, go down into its abyssal depths, turn on the lights and unlock your new edgier dash ability, and then once you're done, travel all the way back to Fog Canyon and you can finally get past this wall. Right. Now, I'm sorry, but you would have to be a lemon who was on the dev team to think to do all of this without any prior knowledge. And wait, before you type the comment out, I know that you can get to this area another way by using Isma's tear to go through the fungal waste, but that's just as convoluted. And yes, you might have not had any trouble figuring all of this out personally, but you have to think of it from a new player's perspective. This type of trial and error level design leads to a lot of newer players to constantly getting lost. But the question is, was this intentional? How can I describe this world? Bleak, desolate, a 20-piece pack of chicken McNuggets that only came with 19.
Fuck's sake.
This world is decrepit and falling apart, its streets crawling with the mindless drones of a kingdom long past, and the only corners not lost to this madness are crawling with malicious intent.
Do you know what? I'm really depressed.
Now, the argument is, was this feeling of getting lost in its level design and progression intentional to complement the core emotions of its narrative? You have to feel pain before you know the good times are here, right? It might be the same here. Becoming frustrated with the navigation and not being able to do certain things just makes the acquisition of the trams, stag stations, and new abilities all the sweeter in due part to this pain and frustration. But feeling lost and actually getting lost are two completely separate states, and the game proves this with the design of its darkest area, Deep Nest. You've been traveling through the game happily, hopping from area to area, and then suddenly you fall, deep down into the bowels of an unknown area. It is dark, aggressive, and silent. The map you relied so heavily on is gone, and Cornifer is nowhere to be seen or heard. He is silently cowering in a hidden cave, and no sound signifier or hint at where he is. This leads to Deep Nest being an incredibly anxious experience, as you're lost in its maze-like caverns. This was completely intentional, but what about the rest of the world design? What do you think? I want to hear what you have to say in the comments. Was this intentional or a design mishap? Let's have a conversation down below. So, what are my final thoughts on Hollow Knight overall? Well, although I do have my grievances with how the progression of the game is laid out, I still think this game is incredible, and it's well worth your time, with multiple endings and free DLC to add to the insane replay value of this game. I own this game 4 times, for God's sakes, digitally on the PC, PS4, Switch, and a collector's edition. Team Cherry just absolutely smashed this game out of the park, and I cannot wait to see what they have to show us in Silksong, but I guess we'll see. Thank you so much for watching, guys. I really hope you enjoyed today's episode, and I just want to say a big thank you to Escapist and my wonderful patrons for actually making this possible. And if you too do enjoy this series and you want to see more, I actually have my own channel with lots of similar content over there, and I can't wait to see you over there as well as on here on the Escapist. Thank you so much for the support, mate. I'll see you in the next one.